there's not a lot you can say after that, except that that is exquisite. That Secret Garden with the voices of Brian Kennedy, Tracy Campbell Nation, and the London Community Gospel Choir, and Anuna, and You Raise Me Up. Beautiful sound. That's about it from me. Just a final admonition, if you have a look out in your yard, and if there is not a 16-stone potbelly pig where there should be one, you've lost it. But the good news is that somebody has found it and they're waiting for you to claim it, as long as they don't have to feed it for too long. I'll be back tomorrow morning. If you can't contain yourself until then, you can email me, jb@bbc.co.uk. Gerry Anderson is next.
16-stone pig?
Mm.
Did you find it?
It's not mine.
Do you know, I was thinking, you could have saved yourself a lot of trouble. It wasn't Vanessa Feltz on the John Daly Show recently?
No comment.
And another thing, too, do you remember the time a while back when people from the South, we call them Southerners, were sending their pigs up here to be slaughtered because of some kind of agricultural regulation? Do you remember that?
Yes.
I remember there was a campaign on this program. I know you didn't take it up because you didn't feel sympathetic towards it. Our slogan was, keep Ulster bacon alive, kill our pigs first.
That's very unfeeling.
No, but do you know what I mean? I think we've done things that in the past that we have to be proud of. And I think it's only fair that now that the subject of the 16-stone pig has come up, I should remind the people about our Kill Our Pigs First campaign.
Pigs have feelings too, you know.
They do indeed.
They're very intelligent creatures, they tell me.
I know. I used to have a pet one.
Did you eat it?
No, I cured it.
Did you hear the story about the three-legged pig?
No, well, I know you're going to tell me.
Well, I'll tell you. This motorist was driving along, and he looked out, and there was a pig with three legs.
Mm-hmm.
And he couldn't contain himself any longer. He went up to the farm door, and he knocked the door, and he said, excuse me, I hope you don't mind me asking, but why has that pig only got three legs?
Yes.
I'm not keeping you. And the farmer said, well, there's a story behind this. That is a very, very unusual pig.
You can't remember the end of this,
can you? I can, yes. He said, there was a fire here about a year ago, and that pig woke us all up by hitting its snout against the door. And the man said, but why does it only get three legs? And the farmer said, well, now, you wouldn't eat a pig like that all in one go, would you?
Oh. Susan, you're allowed to laugh now.
Oh, am I right? So
No, she was trying to contain herself there, uh-huh, because she didn't realise she wasn't on air.
Morning, but, John.
Good morning, Susan.
Why were we called Southerners?
When you live in the West.
We were also called Free Staters and we weren't very free, let me tell you.
I'm sorry, I didn't realise you were listening when I started whilst I was talking to a fellow Northerner about Southerners. But then again, of course, you well know that Malin Head, the southerly point of Ireland, is in the most northerly point of Ireland is in the south.
Exactly.
A lot of people don't understand that.
Mm-hmm. Are we doing geography now, aren't we?
We are indeed, yes.
And a bit of politics fired in.
A bit of political geography, okay.
But yeah. You found your pig anyway. John was looking for a 16-stone pig.
No, I wasn't looking for it. I was just informing the people that we may have lost it. I'm getting bored with this conversation.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. We'll let you go then.
I've only one thing to say to you.
What's that? Beautifully put.
Every day is the rainy season, every night is a full moon. Whenever I'm with you, darling, love is a monsoon. Love is a monsoon. Goosebumps all around my skin whenever you come into the room. Fresh, wild smell of jasmine. Love is a monsoon. Love is a monsoon. A rainy day, it's coming my way. Alone, I walk the hillside alone, pace the sand alone. Think about you, I close my eyes, kiss your hand alone. Lick the rain streaming down upon your face. Alone, see the moment, we're together in a higher place. Alone, sing your praises alone. Let you know alone, you make the ripples, honey water afterglow. Love is a monsoon. Love is a monsoon. A rainy day, it's coming my way.
Keep Ulster bacon alive, kill Ulster pigs first.
of wisdom in the mountain, the silent touch in the river, the juices flow to the rhythm that I need so much outside. The roar of thunder, streets drip wet in the rain inside. Honey water lingers, please God we'll meet again. Every day is the rainy season, every night is a full moon. Whenever I'm with you, darling, love is a monsoon. Love is a monsoon. Goosebumps all around my skin whenever you come into the room. Fresh wild, smell of jasmine. Love is a monsoon. Love is a monsoon. Love is a monsoon. Coming my way,
that's the old Sergeant Pepper's going on in the back there. That's Luca Bloom, funnily enough. That's a great song. It's called Love is a Monsoon. No, it's not called that at all. It's called Monsoon. And it's from a new album by Luca Bloom. It's called Between the Mountain and the Moon. He'll be touring Ireland in May, apparently, if you believe that. He's now currently in Europe and Australia, which is difficult. Right, here's a letter from... It's an email from Ronnie Hollywood, which is a great name. I'd love to be called Ronnie Hollywood. Hello, what's your name? Hello, my name is Ronnie Hollywood. He says, interesting though the explanations of the Morse code shipping distress signals were on yesterday's programme, especially the erudite-sounding lady with the Latin explanation, the acronyms given were false, as these distress signals were simply nonsense strings. Now, I don't know what a nonsense string is, but he says it means something. We were talking yesterday about what various codes were talked about on the Titanic, basically, is what we were talking about. Up until 1908, CQD had been the signal used, but at an international radio telegraph convention in that year, SOS was chosen as a universal distress signal. It was chosen because it was easily sent and understood in Morse code because of the letters involved. Three dots, three dashes, and three dots. Three dots, three dashes, do-do-do. CQD didn't mean come quickly danger, stroke disaster, nor does SOS mean save our souls, save our ship, stop our signals, or even sic opus sit. The telegraph operators on the Titanic initially used the old CQD signal, and it wasn't until the ship was nearly under the briny that they began using the new SOS signal. Indeed, the first recorded mention of the false acronym, Save Our Souls, is in reference to the sinking of the Titanic, which probably accounts for its widespread use and endurance. So there we are. So you didn't know that. The Titanic was basically one of the first ships to use the SOS signal, and then it became associated with the Titanic. Yet another legend is born. Ronnie Hollywood tells us that, and he says, how do I know this? There's a website which is called uselessinformation.com. Did you see everybody dressed up in the City Hall last night with the Titanic meme?
I did.
Did you see that?
I did.
We could have done without the false moustaches, I think. Everybody dressed up in period dress. I would like to have been at that, but unfortunately we didn't. We weren't invited.
Did you see the programme last night on Titanic?
Yes, I did. I think I saw that before.
I don't know if you did or not.
Maybe bits of it.
I think so.
I remember seeing the little lad being brought down to see the Titanic by his father.
That's right. I remember you by
I remember talking to John. John Bennett worked on the Titanic, you know. I didn't know that. He keeps it close to his chest. He was a rivet thrower.
Do you know what fascinated me?
Mm-hmm.
Which is one picture last night.
Yes.
The old black and white pictures they were showing.
Uh-huh.
Horses and carts. I never thought about horses and carts being were used.
How else would they get the stuff?
I know, but when it's until I saw the horse and cart, mm-hmm. I said, Mike.
You think 1912? Not a lot of lorries there, you know? No. And when you look at the big pistons, and you look at the big brace and brackets or whatever you call them, and you wonder how they got them on the ship. Mm-hmm. I mean, imagine coming down there with a horse and cart with a big engine on it.
But I want to see that documentary that was on a Sunday afternoon. I want to see that again because I missed the
Just
start of it.
Control yourself.
You know?
see what we can do, but I can't promise you anything.
All right, then.
Okay?
Okay, thank you.
Please say a very happy birthday to my mother, Violet O'Mullen, whose birthday it is today. She's a fan of the show and listens every day. That's from Siobhan O'Mullen. Happy birthday, Violet. I think it's today, isn't it? Yes, I think it's today. I hope we've got the right day. I was wondering if you could tell our listeners, says Warren M., Warren Mitchell. He used to be. No, it's a different one. I was wondering if you could tell our listeners the address of your unofficial website. Well, I keep telling people, but, you know, people don't seem to hear. David Dunseith always said that. They're not listening. It's... What is it? Properties, that's it. www.propertysnaps, P-R-O-P-E-R-T-Y-S-N-A-P-S, propertysnaps.co.uk/Cherry Anderson, all one word, all lowercase. This is an unofficial site. It's not a BBC site because they don't want us on theirs. And there's not...
That.
What?
If a man logs on to that, can a man hear your program on?
No, a man can hear a snippet of the program and can read a false script. But also, if a man wants to hear this program, he logs on to the BBC site. Well, they can't help but keep us off it.
See, a man phoned me from Chester last night and asked for your...
No good. You can't hear us on the unofficial website. You're for God's official, sake, man.
You're on the official BBC?
Of course we are.
Okay. Well, where do they find you on that?
That's a hard question. Go and ask somebody out there and then tell me after. It's bbc.co.uk stroke thing. I don't know, whatever it is. Look, that's very... You put me in the spot here. I don't know off the top of my head. John Bennett knows things like that. He knows his postcode.
Why don't you log into John Bennett's?
What?
Why don't you log into John Bennett's?
Sure, he's finished. It's only dungeon games and things like that and wee funny things that you don't want. We haven't got a website. There's nothing.
Yeah, but
on
if you log in now to John Bennett.
Yes. You'll hear me.
No, you won't.
Yes.
Will you? No, you won't.
No, but you can log on to me.
Well, you'll see his website.
You can log on to. You can log on to bbc.co.uk/Radio Ulster.
Yes.
And then that brings you to Radio Foyle as well, and you can hear Radio Foyle and Radio Ulster, two separate entities, although it's me on the both of them.
Right.
Anyway, that's the address of the website. And, dear Jerry, please play a request of your choice for Mary Martin and her husband Jim, who'll be celebrating their 30th wedding anniversary next week. Mary is an avid listener and will be working hard in the laundry and the Marina nursing home in Ballyronan. Best wishes to them both. That's from the Boyd family. I've got a little poem here, which I think I should read. It concerns something that happened the other day. Apparently, I was talking on this program, and a lot of people a lot of people thought that I said a naughty word, whereas I didn't. I played the tape back to prove that I didn't. So a poem has been written by John McMenamin called The Anderson Tapes. You may remember the film. This is how it goes. Was there a cover-up at Radio Foyle? Was Jerry's language really foul? Once again, our hero did escape, but did someone tamper with the audio tape? Was vigorous testing ever completed to find expletives which were deleted? Did Jerry say F or was it B? Did people choke whilst drinking their tea? Dear Michael now is quick to follow, come on like an Ayatollah. Chastened our hero rather severely, a fundamentalist? Yes, quite clearly. Warned him of his place and station, a role model to the Irish nation. Said, come here, hi Jerry, get out of the muck. And don't say that word that rhymes with duck. And Mr. Coyle, it seemed to me, stirred the pot with fiendish glee. Is he a friend or is he a foe? Does he want our hero brought down low? Yes. And when I think back to that day, I see the hand of the CIA. Watergate comes into focus, deep throat and all that hocus pocus. Is the plan to see our hero fall? Was Sean Coyle on the grassy knoll? And quoting from Dick Nixon's book, Gerry Anderson is not a crook. So I think we should have a commission. Warren factions should be fishing. Dirty tricks are not much fun. And just who is that man on one? Mr. Coyle should be investigated, scrutinised on the things he stated, because on Radio Foyle, I'm telling you, he could be trying to pull a coup. In a violent time warp, still we're stuck, but don't use that word that rhymes with duck. I think back to a little poem taught at my mother's knee. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never, ever hurt me. So Jerry, son, have a nice day, but do be careful what you say. And though people huff and puff and scowl, keep your eyes on Mr. Coyle. Here's this nice song again. Tom's song.
Fall me from heaven now. Fall
Everybody loves that song, and so do I have to be honest with you. It's Marie Murray, a local girl here from Derrystoke, Londonderry, and that's a song called Tom's Song. That was recorded by Fergal Murray, her brother, and played piano, and he wrote the music and arranged it. The whole thing was done by them. It's not commercially available, although a lot of people have been asking me, but yeah, if anyone out there should distribute that and get that on sale, because that sounds like a hit to me. I have a letter here from a lady called what
about your call?
Excuse me, Sean, I think I'm the presenter.
I understand that, but I didn't know whether you remembered or not.
What do you think I am?
I understand, but it was a while since we talked.
But what do you think I am? 105 years old? I mean, do you think I just forget things immediately? You know?
There's coffee in one.
I know that. I was getting round to it. There's no need to snap.
I'm not snapping, I'm only...
You're snapping out
I'm
of...
Not.
People don't hear you snapping, but I hear you snapping. Hello?
Good morning.
Good morning. I'm sorry for keeping you.
Yeah, well, have you had the query we have from Enniskillen about a hedgehog? No.
No.
Well, we have a friend who has a hedgehog in her garden, and we have suggested she put out some milk for him at night.
I don't know if that's a good idea or not.
Well, I don't know, but perhaps you could find out. I'm sure Georgie knows.
Georgie?
Aye.
Uh-huh. I think in the back of my... medulla, I think it is.
Yes.
I think I remember somebody telling me that maybe milk is not the best thing to give a hedgehog.
Aye, somebody said that.
I don't know. I just something a little alarm bell goes off in my brain about that.
That is a lovely song you're after playing.
Isn't it lovely?
Yes, it is very nice.
That's the purest voice I've ever heard.
That's right, it's very nice.
She sings like an angel.
Very like Eva Cassidy.
I think she's better than Eva Cassidy.
Yeah, she's very nice.
Yeah, it's kind of, you know, that beautiful, pure voice.
Easy to listen to, just like yourself. And your program's very good, and we enjoy it in Enniskillen every morning.
Well, thank you very much. I'm going up to Enniskillen on Friday.
Oh, good.
I'm going up to talk to a couple of people.
Well, we're going to Donegal Town, our famous town.
Are you?
Yes.
On when?
This afternoon.
Are you going to Donegal Town itself?
Yes. And we're going to go into that new hotel. Have you been in there?
Which one's that?
The one as you go in from the Enniskillen area.
Is it a new one? I don't know.
It's a brand new one. It's just beside, before you come to the Central. Oh, it's massive.
I don't know. Oh, yes, I know the one you mean.
Yes.
I can't remember the name of it, though.
No, me either.
But is that not a bit big for you?
No, it would be big, and I'm a wee woman.
But you should be in a wee old hotel. I'm not saying because you're a wee old woman. No, I'm not saying you're a wee old woman.
I know, I am a wee old woman, but no, anyway.
I'll tell you one thing, about I don't like big hotels in Donegal.
No, me either. I don't like flash.
Because Donegal doesn't suit big hotels.
No, well, we go to Glencolumbkill all the time.
Oh,
and
yes.
And we love it.
Yes. What do you call that hotel there? There's a hotel there that's very nice. Glen Bay. Yes.
That's right.
That's nice there.
Yes.
I often go there.
Yes.
No, not often, but... Sorry.
I know you have connections with Donegal.
When was the last time you were there?
I'm lying automatically.
I know, yes. You know.
When was the last time I was there?
Yes. I often go there.
4 years ago.
Yeah. Listen.
I knew as soon as I said it.
I know.
I knew as soon as I said it. You know the way you like to try... I'm trying to make the lady feel good.
I know.
You know, and I suddenly realised I was lying.
I know. Well, anyway, your program's very nice, and you find out about the hedgehog, so we'll keep lifting.
Geordie recommended that you give the hedgehog cat meat, and that was poo-pooed, if you know what I mean.
Oh, yeah.
Who poo-pooed the cat meat? Oh, that was it. That's the little bell that was going off in my head.
You don't give a hedgehog cat meat. I think.
You know, some things are very obvious. I remember a woman talking to me one time, and I don't know if it was on this program or not, but actually, as a lady, I was talking to on the phone, because sometimes I talk to quite a lot of people before I come on.
Yes.
I don't talk to anyone after, but I talk to people before I come on. And she said to me, I'll never forget, she said, "I've lost a cockatiel." And I said, "Have you really?" She said, "I've lost a cockatiel." I said, "Whereabouts is this cockatiel?" "It's Ballymena." I said, "Well, you know, it's hard to get a cockatiel back, especially this is in the winter, because the climate is against us, and there's a lot of hawks and buzzards out there, you know, just looking for a cockatiel. It's not as if you can hide a cockatiel, because they're all yellow and purple and orange, you know, and there's not too many yellow and purple and orange birds flying about Ballymena in the winter, you know, and they're kind of, it's like McDonald's in the air, do you know what I mean, for a lot of other birds." And she said, "When you find it," she said, "when you find it, let me know." I said, "Well, we may not be able to find it." And she said, "Why, you'll find it all right." He says, "When you find it, let me know. But I'll tell you what, if anyone else finds it, tell them this." I said, "Tell them what?" "Tell them it doesn't like chicken."
Well, all the best, and thank you for ringing.
That was very quick.
Yeah, okay, thank you, bye.
Bye.
Bye. I don't think she liked that.
No, there's a man. There's a man.
Where did she go? Well, she went away there just immediately.
No, she thought you were finished with her. She just went away.
But they don't usually go when I'm finished with them.
No, there's a man.
They usually hang about too long.
There's a man who wants to ask you a question. He's looking some help.
Looking help?
Yeah.
What did she want? Do you remember? Did we get to the bottom of it? What did she want?
Should you give a...
Ah, yes. So it's all right to give a hedgehog milk, but not cat milk.
Not cat.
And don't give cockatiel's chicken. That's like feeding bacon to a pig.
Right.
Hello?
Hello there.
Good morning, sir.
How are you?
I'm sorry for being less than serious today. You may have a serious query, I don't know.
Right. That's about this White Star Line.
Oh, yes, okay.
How many ships was on the White Star Line?
How many ships?
Yes.
Well, I know there were kind of three big ones, the Titanic, the Britannic, and the Olympic,
right.
Whatever you call it. But I'm sure there was a lot more.
I'm sure that's out of existence now.
Oh, yeah, they're all gone, yeah. Some went quicker than others.
I'll tell you why. I have a trunk here. With the White Star Line stamp on the side of it.
You have a trunk?
Oh
dear.
It's black.
Yes.
I'd like leather with someone harder in behind the leather. It's done over with leather.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just wondering if there was any an existence at all.
Any what in existence? Any
trunks.
Trunks?
Are these big trunks.
Well, do you know who that belonged to, that trunk that you have?
No.
Well, how did you come upon it?
Oh, I'd come from my uncle's house a few years ago.
Well, was he a man who was at sea at all, or anyone?
No, he wasn't at sea at all, but he had a lot of brothers went to America and all that way, and how it got there now, I just wouldn't know.
Right. Is there any indication on the trunk of anything else? It just says White Star Line.
It just says White Star Line. It's stamped with it's in blue and a white star in the middle of this wee blue square.
Oh, I'd love to have that.
And there's a whole lot of things in there, but what did I tell you about what's in it? There's a fair bit of Irish linen in it.
Yes.
And other sorts of clothes, but there's two women's nightdresses in it.
Yeah.
And I don't know what height they were, for I'm nearly 6 foot.
Uh-huh.
And I held one of them up to my shoulders one day, and there was as much in the ground.
Well, I hope nobody saw you doing that.
No.
Yeah, okay.
And I was wondering, what height were they, or did they use it for wrapping themselves up in bed or what. Well, that's all in this trunk that come down. It's full of stuff.
What else is in it?
There'll be linen, pillowcases and things like that.
You mean when you got the trunk, it was full of stuff?
Oh, it was full. It was just to the very same as it was the day I brought it down home here.
My God, you should keep that, you know. You shouldn't. You really should. You should bring that along to somebody. You should get someone to have a look at that, you know. Because, I mean, that could be anything. I mean, that could be very, I don't know, but it strikes me as being a very unusual thing. I mean, there's many in our trunk knocking about. And I have to say, I've never seen a White Star Line trunk. But, I mean, for a White Star Line trunk to be actually packed, do you know what I mean? It's very unusual.
But I would think what was in it wasn't in it when it came into their hands, probably. The stuff was planted all over the years.
Well, yeah, that's a possibility. But, you know, maybe somebody would like to look at that. That might be interesting. But then again, you never know that trunk. I mean, was that trunk in use in your... Was it your uncle, did you say?
It was my uncle's.
Was it in use in your uncle's house? Or was it just stashed in the attic?
It was... I can't mind whereabouts it was around the yard. I read out a lot of old shades about it.
Well, you see, if it was in the yard in an old outhouse or something like that, chances are it wasn't being used on a daily basis, so maybe the stuff that was in it was in there since. Do you know what I mean?
Could be, too. I never thought of that.
Well, where do you live? You're up around, where do you live in at the moment?
Tunbridge.
Tunbridge?
Yeah.
Well, you know, maybe someone out there who knows a bit more than I, and there's many people who do. Maybe they might be interested in having a look at that.
Well, I was just wondering, like, how long the White Star Line is out of existence and how many ships were on the White Star Line.
Well, I'm sure someone out there will be able to tell us.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of experts out there, as you well know. A lot of people interested in the White Star Line because of the Titanic connection. So if anybody out there knows that when the White Star, for all I know, it could be still in existence, I don't know. When it went out of business and how many ships and... Did you really examine that trunk very carefully? You should really have a really good, fine look at it.
I just looked around the side of it there. I went out just to have another look at it to make sure the White Star was on and it was. It is. And... Whenever you lift the lid there, all you see is these garments and clothes and tablecloths and stuff that was in it.
Well, I would say, you know, I would guess that someone's going to ring up here and want to see that.
Well, that's all right.
If you don't mind. I'm sure they would. Because somebody, I'm sure people would want to look at that. But what kind of nick is it in? Is the case, the trunk in good condition?
Oh, it's in good condition. The only thing, you know, the buckles or whatever you'd call it had been in gold.
Yes, yes.
But them's rusted nearly all away now. The gold is all you can see now is the rust, and the lug on has been forced open at some time.
Yes.
But on that thing's in good condition.
Uh huh.
Well,
obviously, I wouldn't say it was gold then if it's rusted.
No,
it's probably
gold.
You know, probably, but you never know what it was. So it came from your uncle. And there's no indication of any kind of date on it or anything like that.
Well, I never looked for a date now.
You should have a good peep through it, you know. You should take the clothes out. And, you know, but try and keep them in the way they were packed in there. Maybe you should just leave them. Just leave them there. Leave them there. Sorry, what was that?
I never said a word.
Well, somebody said something to my ear. Was that not you?
It wasn't me.
Oh, I'm sorry, it was somebody else. It must be a cross line.
Yeah.
Mel used to get cross lines.
Yeah. And by the way, you were right about the hedgehog.
Sorry, no, I'm just talking to this man here.
I know you are.
About what? The hedgehog?
Yeah, you don't give
no
it.
No milk.
Don't give it milk.
I knew that.
Yeah, you were right.
I knew that. Sorry about that. We're being distracted here by hedgehogs and milk and cat food. Listen, I'd be surprised if someone didn't ring up and request your phone number so they could have a chat to you so they could maybe have a look at that.
That's all right.
So you can expect that. You don't mind that, do you?
No, not at all. No, no.
Well, thanks very much. It's been interesting talking to you. And you never know what you have there. And if nothing else, you've got a very significant memento.
I would have thought that around this time and yesterday on Albion's anniversary.
I'd
come into my head about this thing again.
Oh, yeah.
Many a time and knew there was such a thing as the White Star Line, and then I heard the Titanic was one of them ships.
That's right, that's right.
And then I was wondering, was any more? Many?
Well, there was at least, there was three huge ones, and, you know, I'm sure there were other ones, I don't know. Yeah. But we'll find out for you.
That'll do well.
All right, thanks very much, and thank you for ringing.
Goodbye.
Okay, bye. But I liked him.
He's a nice man, wasn't he?
That's the type of man. There's a lot of men like that in Northern Ireland. You know, they're not. Mm-hmm. You know, they're not like, you know, George or Hugo.
He would be a man that would be, you would like him as an uncle.
I would like to talk, to,
would
him,
talk to him.
I'd like to have a wee bottle of stout with him some night, and he would go to bed early.
With you?
No, I hope not. It's coming up to 11 o'clock. We'll be back after the news.
92 to 95 FM
and 1341 medium wave.
BBC Radio Ulster.
It's 11 o'clock and with the news, this is Jackie Godfrey. MPs are gathering at Westminster to pay tribute to the Queen Mother. A special session of Parliament will begin in the next half hour. There will be a minute's silence before the Prime Minister leads the tributes. But a minority of MPs are unhappy that Parliament is being called back from its Easter break. Labour backbencher Alan Simpson says in his view MPs should be discussing the situation in the Middle East and shouldn't be at Westminster simply to pay tribute to the Queen Mother.
We let society and democracy down when we duck the big issues around which difficult decisions have to be made and recall Parliament simply to provide a platform for tributes that people can make in other ways.
The Northern Ireland and Welsh Assemblies will meet tomorrow to reflect on the life of the Queen Mother. Israeli tanks and soldiers have taken control of two more Palestinian towns in the West Bank. Forces moved in to Jenin and Salfit overnight, extending their operation against suspected militants. Israel has also warned of dangerous consequences if Hezbollah guerrillas continue their attacks from neighbouring Lebanon. The BBC's correspondent in Ramallah, Barbara Plett, said the latest move by the Israelis were significant.
This is a bigger military operation, I believe, than anything that we've seen. Now, the Israelis did invade the Palestinian territories in a massive way in the middle of March. But this is bigger than that, and I think that that's because they felt that they didn't finish the job in mid-March. Then they did also have a very limited window of opportunity because of international criticism, and it was stopped short by this U.S. peace initiative or U.S. ceasefire initiative. And there was a great deal of criticism of that operation because they didn't really net that many militants. And I think that's why you're seeing such a push now.
The security alert at the offices of the Irish News in Donegal Street in Belfast was a hoax. Army bomb disposal experts were called to the offices this morning to examine a suspect package. The soccer legend George Best is being honoured this morning. He has been given the freedom of the borough of Castlereagh. Kevin Sharkey reports.
At a ceremony beginning at the Castle Civic Offices around now, George Best is being made an honorary freeman of Castlereagh. Later, a plaque will be unveiled at his family home in Craiga. The council says the honour recognises an exceptional sporting talent and Best's outstanding contribution to the game of soccer. This morning's ceremony is being attended by his wife Alex and his extended family, as well as friends from the world of sport and former colleagues from an illustrious football career spanning the 1960s and early 70s.
Finally, the Vietnamese pot-bellied pig found in a garden in Carrickfergus this morning has been reunited with its owner, former UDP chairman John White. The pig, called Maisie, was found by children who fed it with biscuits, pears, apples and bananas. Mr. White heard an appeal on Radio Ulster and came to collect his pet. He said it had wandered about 2 miles from his home to end up in Plantation Drive, Carrick.
BBC Radio Ulster.
Travel news.
In the Antrim area, new traffic lights are being installed on the A6 Belfast Road at the Old Stone Road Junction. Traffic controls are in force. The Duplis Road in Newton Stewart is closed as a new pedestrian underpass is being built. Again, diversions are in place. And in Macrofell, the northbound carriageway of Queen Street remains closed due to footpath reconstruction work. Diversions are signposted. Deirdre Horshall with the Travel News.
And the weather, cloudy this morning with spells of showery rain, brighter and drier this afternoon, maximum temperature 13 degrees. And that's all from the news desk until midday, BBC Radio Ulster News.
There we go. BBC Radio Ulster hits the news. I can never see the headlines tomorrow. Bennett finds Vietnamese pot-bellied pig for John White.
I will sit a comfortable 2 square on your body, then I'll begin.
Dreams. Deep inside a rainbow lived happiness man. in a small Victoriana charabanc. Evening will be here quite soon. Stand and sit and watch the moon. Watching as the white light slowly makes the night bright. Are skipping by while time stands still.
That is. That sounds terribly dated, doesn't it? That's the thing I came across the other day. That's Stanley Unwin, who died recently at the start of that. That's an album by the Small Faces, of all people. It's called Ogden's Not Gone Flake. Eh? And that's a song called Happiness Stan. I just thought that was unusual. Hello, good morning, Geordie.
Well, Gerry.
Did you hear on the news about the Vietnamese potbelly
pig? I heard that. Oh, see, they're all coming on these potbellies, but Al Hooch was here first.
Did Hooch hear that on the radio?
No, he's out eating potatoes.
Just as well.
Refuse, aye.
Is he eating potatoes that have been given to you, or is he just...
Yes, I get these. My neighbour down the road, Davy Cardwell, there, he gives them what you call a refuse.
Refuse.
And I boil them, you see, and put yellow meal in them, and then ducks evenates them.
Yeah, the sort of thing that used to give hens, that kind of thing.
Oh,
yeah. The potato skins, potatoes, bits of things thrown in. And then Hooch enjoys that.
Oh, yes. Oh, why?
I don't think he'd like being owned by John White.
No, I don't think so.
No, I don't think so. I think he'd prefer you as an owner.
I don't think he's the best pig,
anyhow. I know. We had a query this morning about hedgehogs and milk, but you actually, on this programme before, told us, erroneously...
No,
I have to
no,
say.
I'm right. The wee thing, I kept food and do it no harm.
Well, we had
exactly it that thing.
You see, we had a reaction to that. You see, sometimes that you know,
like the jazz flute.
Let's not talk about that. Tell him about that.
I know.
Tell Geordie about that.
No, but Geordie's right. Geordie says not to give it milk.
Yes, don't give it milk. A couple of spoonfuls of cat food, yes, that'll eat and it'll do it no harm.
Well, did we not get a reaction the last time that we suggested that hedgehogs be fed cat food? Did we not get a reaction to say that it was flying in the face of medical science, that indeed
we recommended we give it milk and it was wrong.
Yes, we think a cat food will do it no harm.
Well, what about a liquid? I think we're talking liquids here.
A glass of water.
But you have a hedgehog lift a glass.
Yeah.
No, what would you recommend? It's your water, for God's sake.
A wee bit of fruit.
A wee bit of fruit?
A wee apple.
You're just making that up as you go along.
I heard that.
No, it eats slugs and stuff. A wee hedgehog eats slugs. And I'll tell you what, dude, it would suck an egg. The same wee boy.
Would it really?
Oh, why?
That would be hard for a hedgehog.
Oh, no, he can do it all right.
Have you ever seen a hedgehog suck an egg?
Indeed, yes.
That's the thing that many of us have never seen.
Oh, well, I've run across the nest right a wee bounty clock and the hedgehog sucked the whole lot of Oh, why?
Much to the displeasure of the bounty female, I would imagine. Did you ever? You were looking for something the other. No, somebody else was looking for banties.
Geordie's had an addition to the farm.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yes.
Well, Barney's goat. You mean the goat with my tree, Barney's window?
Yes. Yes, I do.
You mean the buck goat that jumped through Barney's window?
Just for the benefit of new listeners, what actually happened was that this goat was seen on a number of occasions standing on top of the duckle. Was that it? Staring
sort of a wee mound.
A small mound, which was some way from Barney's window.
Yes.
A man called Barney.
Uh-huh.
And for some days, the goat was noticed standing on this mound, staring at the window, and appearing to be looking into the home in
That's
which
right.
Barney was living.
Mm-hmm.
And then one, was it lunchtime? Barney was having
yes,
his dinner?
He was putting it out, the plates and stuff in the dinner, and he just landed on top of the table and racked it.
Lo and behold, the goat came through the window yes. of its own volition uh-huh. and landed in the middle of his dinner.
Yes.
And the popular theory was that the goat did not realise that Barney was having his dinner at the time, but the Barney, sorry, the goat, had been staring at the window for such a long time at his own reflection, and then suddenly could take it no more, charged at the reflection, not knowing that Barney was sitting inside having his meal. And indeed, Barney was surprised to find a goat coming through the window at him. And indeed, probably took evasive action, I'd say.
Well, you see, Jerry Barney, give me a wee she-goat, you say.
Well, would you not be afraid that that goat would do the same to you?
No, this is a wee she-goat.
It's not the same goat that's
no,
through Barney's window.
It's not the buck goat. No, Barney, give me a wee she-goat.
Right. And was it a baby she-goat?
No. And he says, now, I have a goat too the same time, and she's kidded, he says, a week ago. So he says, yours could be, you know. And sure enough, on Good Friday, she had a wee kid.
Mm-hmm.
And a wee buck too, a wee white one, lovely wee thing.
A wee buck and a kid?
So you, as a wee buck.
You have the kid?
Oh, yes, and the wee goat, she kidded, and there's a lovely wee thing.
Well, I'll tell you what. I would say there's a lot of people out there would like to see that wee goat.
Fuck, they were here, Jerry, there with the dapplers out there, were taking photographs, and the wee kid howling. You know, people calling for eggs and stuff around Easter, you know.
So you had the wee kid running over the daffodils?
Ah.
Oh, that would be lovely, wouldn't it?
And I was way down in Loch Galris.
Uh-huh.
Just a wee air, and you know my wee late friend, down that's where she's buried, in Tuckalaka.
And yes.
And stuff. Yes.
Yes, yes.
And sat them in. A wee friend, well, a good relation from Porty Down, she called up and took me down.
Mm-hmm.
And tidied it up and all. And then, do you know we were called in? Do you ever tell the grace in?
Oh, I did indeed. It's good in there.
Now, yes. This lady doesn't have drinking or smoking, you know.
Yes, I know.
But I bought her, you know, her dinner.
Mm-hmm. What did you have? What did she have for her dinner?
She had plates and chips and all the trimmings. And
sounds good.
Oh, yes, a nice spot, though.
Mm-hmm. I've been in there before.
There you are.
Yeah?
You see.
And you'd recommend that, then?
Oh, yes, there's lovely country down there, Jerry.
Oh, it is indeed. It's a beautiful country, especially this time of the year. I always think at this time, well, you know, maybe in a couple of weeks' time, when this cold weather goes away, this is the best time of the year.
Uh-huh.
Round about April, May is the best time of the year.
There's our hoots dawdling now into the shade.
Is he coming in?
He's there now. Mm-hmm. I see him through the window.
He's had his fill of the refuse.
Oh, he has, yes, and he takes a walk around.
Mm-hmm.
He's there dawdling on up the yard now.
What would make a pig leave John White? And,
I do not. Well, now I could not be.
I think of a number of reasons.
I could. Oh, before I go, Jerry.
Yes.
Do you know the lady phoned you one time?
Mm-hmm.
You know the ones that pick themselves out now and again and have nights here and days? Or...
Oh, they're fine women, you know. They were making inquiries to me about
you. Oh, yes,
you, you
well, they really phoned me, but I'm not saying when now, but shortly they're coming up to see me.
I was a little worried about that.
Oh, they're coming up and they don't mind the poo or anything else.
Well, I don't know if they mind the poo or not, to be honest with you, but I didn't get that far. It's probably a little bit more information than they need. But I was a little worried about them, not from their point of view, you know, because I know that you're a man of the world and... You're not liable to spring on them as soon as they walk in the door.
No.
But I was a little worried about, you know, how you would take
well,
it.
Well, now, they're coming up anyhow, and I'm not saying when. If there's luck, old cheeses around here, you know, never married, and, you know, I'm not saying when they're coming, but shortly they're coming up.
Okay, that's okay, because you wouldn't want to tell people when they're coming.
No, no.
But I just have to say this to you. There's a number of them, and they're fine-looking pups.
Well...
You might have difficulty restraining yourself.
Ach, nay.
I don't mean that in any unlawful way, but I'm just saying that this may disturb you, may cause you to lose a night or two sleep.
Ach, not at all. No.
But if I was you, as your physician and indeed as your personal broadcaster, I suggest that you become friendly with these women and perhaps accompany them every now and again.
Oh, certainly. You can take a dawdle about and see, have a wee clock and bonty sitting at the minute.
Well, there's nothing that stirs a woman's heart more than a wee clock and banty sitting at the minute.
Aye.
And once they see the gid frolicking around the daffodils, they're gone.
Well,
their legs will turn to water.
So they want, but I think they're coming up the range when they go down to this May Ball.
Why, okay.
You know, down in Belfast.
Oh, I know. I'm not quite sure if they want the the date of that publicised or not.
Well, no, that's up to them.
Exactly. Maybe they'll let me know if they want that.
Well,
but
that's
they are.
Why they're coming up. They want me down there, you see.
Well, if I was you, I would go
coming
there. But
up, they're coming up and, you know.
But it may be more than you can stand.
What?
It may be more than you can stand. I'm telling you, because I know what it's like, because I'm, you know, I'm hard-bitten enough.
This, are you not going?
I don't know if I can handle that or not. I think I'd make a fool of myself.
Oh, no.
You know what I'm like when the drink's in?
Oh, you're not. No.
You know what I'm like down there?
You look, you're better than that now.
Hazel would like to join in the conversation.
Why?
I think it's something about either a dog or a hedgehog, or maybe both.
Maybe both. Maybe a combination of both.
Yes, I think she's trying to train a dog.
A dog with porcupine quills.
She's trying to train a dog in a car or something.
A dog in a car?
She takes the dog... I don't.
Why don't you train it outside? It's hardly room to...
No, no. Let Hazel talk.
Hello, Hazel.
Hello, Jerry.
You're through to Geordie. I believe you're trying... What, you're trying
to...
How
are you?
I'm fine, thanks.
Oh, you make me laugh. Well, you really do. you made me laugh so much, I almost crashed the car.
Oh, well, that's no good. Had you your seatbelt on?
I've just bought a wee dog.
Yes.
It's only 8 weeks old, but this is the first day it's been out in the car.
Mm-hmm. Well, they don't like it, you know.
When you were talking about the hedgehog.
Yeah.
And afterwards she said, what did that woman want? Now that made me laugh.
I didn't know what she wanted, I forgot.
I know you.
But listen, did your wee dog have a wee book?
No, it ended up on my knee.
Oh, they do. You see, dogs need... You know about this, Geordie. Dogs don't like...
It was in the back seat,
no, Jerry. Dear, 8 weeks old is too young to be travelling in the car.
It's too young to be travelling?
No, you have to get them used to it.
No, you see, there is a thing, you know, it may be too young. Why do you think it made the whole journey from the back seat into the front seat? Because I wanted a better view?
Because I hit the curb laughing at you.
It was looking, Jerry, to the lady.
Hold on a minute now. You have to listen to the man. This man knows what he's talking about. Okay. Geordie, why did the dog leap from the back seat to the front seat if it was enjoying
it? Well, it was looking to the lady for a pick-up as his maw, you know. It was looking to get close to her. You know.
What did you say there? What did you say, sorry? Did he say what I thought he said?
Yes, pardon? I think he did.
What did you say there, Geordie?
No, he said it.
What did you say there, Geordie?
I said the wee pup got over the back seat because it was looking close. It thinks the lady is his ma.
Oh, yes, sorry.
And it was looking on his knee because it's looking, you know.
Well, if I was you, love...
Over the back seat.
If I was you, I'd keep me coat closed the next time I'm in the car, I tell you.
Too young.
Like
you might. Oh, God, is there a child around here somewhere? why do the closed tiles round holiday time?
I really don't know. I think it's to prevent people going into them.
Okay, they're all closed.
Now, you see, this is what Northern Ireland is, one of the wonders of the world. You see, this is why, you know, every time I look around me, I say to myself, what's going on here? It's the only place where, you know, they will close toilets at a bank holiday weekend.
Yeah.
Because, you know, people who work in the toilets want to go on their holidays.
This is some,
I know. So it doesn't matter about all the American tourists sitting with their legs crossed. It doesn't matter about that.
Well, at the moment, I think mine are.
Well, listen, Geordie's strangely silent. So what kind of a dog do you have?
I'm listening to that wee lady. She's a nice voice. I'm just listening to her.
Do you think so?
He's starting that old talk again.
No, I'm not now. No, Jerry, would you always bring that in, by
the way? Because I know when you like her, don't you?
No, but she's...
Oh, if he saw me at the Monday, wouldn't he?
No, he likes the sound of you. He likes the sound of you. He'd like you to come up to the house. If he doesn't think you're good looking, he'll hunt you.
Elizabeth Taylor looking like.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the way she is now, or...
No, definitely. She's no wheelchair.
I always say I look like James Dean, the way he looks now. He's been dead for 40 years. Oh, stop.
What? Look up the wee pup now. It's a wee bit young for travelling.
Yes. Well, let's get back to the subject.
Well, at the moment, can you hear it?
It's a wee bit young for travelling.
What do we hear?
I live in Castle Rock. It's only about 3 miles up the road.
Well, Castle Rock's lovely.
A wee pup was never born at that age to sit in the yard. Like, I'm sure it's wondering what it is and the noise of it.
It's wondering why I'm sitting with my legs crossed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there you are. That's what I tell you.
That's because they've closed the toilets.
Yes.
And, well, what kind of a breed of a dog is yours?
It's a wee toy poodle, sure.
A toy poodle. Well, you see, they're a little...
Oh, yes.
You
very,
know, temperamental.
Very
they're very little.
But look, came before the killer rat.
What? I might choke on it.
Yeah, you've got the wrong dog there for killing rats, I think.
It wouldn't be like Tiny.
Tiny be in there like a rat up a spout.
Oh, what?
You see that
like,
man
like a rat up a drainpipe.
See that
like
man
a rat up a drainpipe.
Listen, I suggest that you take your little dog and go down to that lovely beach down in Castle Rock.
Yeah, just take it for a wee walk.
Let it go.
Right. Take it for a wee walk.
Let the dog go. It'll thank you forever.
It has to be warmed.
Pardon?
It has to be warmed.
Oh, yes, get it warmed and get it an injection for the stamp or two and heart.
Oh, I've got all that.
Okay, then. Well, you're a good mother.
Well, you're not doing too bad.
Well, just don't
forget about those cars.
Yeah. Forget about the car in the meantime.
The good Lord
I'm going to have to stop laughing at Jerry. That's the only thing.
What's that?
Jerry makes me laugh so much.
Sorry.
No matter what I'm doing, you make me laugh.
My stomach's sore laughing. Right, well, you treat that poodle gently, okay?
I will indeed, Jerry.
And don't be making it run after and kill rats. All right, see you later.
Okay, bye.
Okay, Geordie, hold on a minute. There's a lady wants to talk to you. They're coming down here. Hello, who's this?
Hello, this
Mary.
Mary Mulholland.
Mary, you're through to Geordie.
Right, thank you.
Yes?
Geordie?
Yes?
We're running a car boot sale at the Orchard Bar car park.
Oh, I know it well.
And you were supposed to turn up last year. Now, this car boot is for the Children's Hospice.
Right.
And I would really love you to turn up because...
What night is it on?
It's on every Thursday night.
Well, I'll help up this Thursday.
Will you?
Do you want me to bring Jack Lafert?
Yeah, yes.
You ask whenever you come for me and we'll treat you...
Royally?
Yes.
Where is this car boot sale?
It's up in the Orchard Bar car park in Newry.
The Orchard Bar car park in Newry?
Yes. The Rathfreyland Road.
Rathfreyland. Well, you know where that is, Geordie. That's not too far away.
It's within... Yeah, Topcoat McCann. McCann's lives up there.
That's right. They come down to the car boot.
Topcoat McCann lives there.
Uh-huh.
See Tommy and Vinny.
Yes.
Topcoat McCann.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Is that his local?
Uh-huh. I would say so, yes.
All right, then. Okay.
Uh-huh.
Well, do you want him to bring Jack the Ferret?
Well, I don't mind. It's up to him.
It's entirely up to you, Geordie, if you want to bring the ferret or not. Okay?
Right, okay.
All right, then.
What time does it start at, Mrs.?
Well, I'm telling you, Geordie, they're there last week they were there from 3:30. It was the first week.
Well,
3:30?
But I mean, around 5 or 6 o'clock, whatever suited you.
Well, I'll maybe hit around about 6.
6 is good, yeah.
Aye. Well, that would do well.
6, you leave your tea in you.
Yes, this Thursday night.
Yes.
Right,
tomorrow night.
All right, then. Tomorrow night?
Aye.
Tomorrow night, yes.
To let us know on Friday how you get on.
I will indeed,
Jack.
All right, now.
Right, okay. And you can ask for me, sure, and I'll get you sorted
phone
out.
Phone numbers.
George.
What?
Where are you?
Mary Mulholland.
I will do, Mary. Yep.
Should we exchange phone numbers? Geordie, do you want Mary's phone number? Mary, do you want Geordie's phone number? Yeah. And there may be a wee problem with transport. That sort of things. Get all that ironed out.
Oh, no. Right. Whatever you say.
All right, then. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay, see you later.
Thank you.
Okay, Jerry.
Hold on a second. Yeah, hold it. Geordie, hold on a second.
There's a lady who wants to know, could Geordie give out the name of the man who sells the miniature ponies again, please?
Yeah. Do you know the man, Geordie, still there?
No, that man, he's away up and away up next... The Donegal border, away up around that
end. That's okay. It doesn't matter. But do you remember...
Away up and... Well, you know that woman used to phone you in. Way up around the Sand Mills or somewhere, he's way up there.
Well, what's his name?
I don't know his name.
Oh, you don't know his name?
I never was talking to him.
Did you not mention the name of a man who had miniature ponies there at one stage?
No, he phoned you in.
Oh, he did. Yeah, that's right. No, it was not. We already didn't know that.
No, he phoned you in.
That's right, yes.
I didn't.
No, that's right. You're absolutely right. Yeah, so if the man who's listening, who has the miniature ponies, is listening, ring in and tell us his name.
But I don't know who wants it.
In other words, we're looking for a man, we don't know his name, and we're looking for a person we don't know their name either. I'll tell you what, let's just forget about the whole thing.
Yes, well.
All right, then.
No, you didn't do, Jerry. You never played out my old Stanley, old Turkey.
Oh, I forgot about Stanley.
And you're playing this and playing that and playing these old dittery dudes.
I know, and the other.
And you didn't play my old Stanley. Often would you get a tape made about a Turkey?
I know, not often. I'll get it hooked out there. Who's that? Have you got somebody there in the house?
Okay,
then.
No,
sorry. All right, Geordie.
Okay, Geordie.
See you later.
All the best.
Bye. I think think I'm going slowly insane. I'm hearing voices. I'm schizophrenic. I have a beautiful mind. See that film, Russell Crowe? Did you see that?
He plays it.
Oh, great film.
What?
Sorry. Just go back to what you were doing, whatever it was. I don't want nobody better off alone. I'm sworn to independence. My heart is made of stone, but you're breaking on through. Oh, there's something about you. I've been tapping my toe to the way you talk. I've been singing along when I watch the way you walk. I got to do something about you. I got this place of mine, it's nice and quiet and I like it fine. Work real hard, got no time for you. But I whiskeyed up my coffee cup, sitting here trying not to call you up. And it's getting to where I don't know what to do. Something about you. Something about you like distant thunder. I can't say I ain't been warned. I mean, there's no shelter to crawl under. Even gonna save me from this storm. There's something about you, babe, I can't shake. Something about you that's been keeping me awake the whole night through. Oh, there's something about you. I got this life of mine, it's nice and quiet and I like it fine. Work real hard, got no time for you. But I whiskeyed up my coffee cup, sitting here trying not to call you. Where I don't know what to do. There's something about you. There's something about you, baby. That's Kevin Welch. That's a song called Something About You. Hello?
Hello?
Yes, who's that?
This is Karen.
Yes, Karen, how are you? Can
how
I help you?
You
at all today?
Pardon?
Can I help you at all today?
Yes, I have a little problem.
Yes?
I have nine little problems.
Nine?
Nine.
Yes.
Have nine puppies.
Yes.
And they all need home.
Do they? What kind of... Oh, great. What kind of puppies do you have?
They are Alsatian Labrador type of... They all look like wee mini Rottweilers, but they're black. Little bits of brown on them, and there's two beautiful gold ones.
Right. And what kind of mothers and fathers do they have?
The mother is a half-breed sort of Alsatian.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful dog.
Yes.
Beautiful temperament.
Yes.
But it's just she's just had a second litter now, which basically she's too old for. And we have got homes for her last litter of puppies.
Uh-huh.
And I don't think I'm going to be able to get homes for nine again.
All right. Nine's a lot to cater
nine
for.
Nine is a lot.
So where do you live roughly? You're in Belfast or what?
We live near Seaford.
Seaford, right, okay.
And it's just that we were speaking to the vet and it's possible that we will only be able to keep a couple of them with her. So it's a case of, you know, get homes or going to have to go to the doggy house.
Oh, dear, dear. In other words, you know, if you don't get a home for them, they'll have to go.
Yes.
In the words of Jim Reeves.
Exactly.
And we don't want that.
So I thought... I spoke to your girl and I says, maybe, she said, speak to Jerry.
Mm-hmm. What do you mean, my girl? How did you know I had one? Where did you find her?
I found her on the telephone.
So, all right then. So anyone out there...
I know you like dogs. I know you
have
a doggy.
I do love dogs, yeah. And, I like them very much, yeah.
I heard you speaking about dogs a few minutes ago.
Mm-hmm. So, oh, yes. All right then. So anyone out there, you're in Seaford.
Anyone out there, I leave my number.
Yeah. And you have them at home with you, have you?
I have them at home with me. Uh-huh. They're beautiful wee puppies, absolutely gorgeous. They were born on Good Friday.
Uh-huh.
So they are just of an age now where it's sort of yay or nay with them type of thing.
Uh-huh.
But they're lovely puppies. Their mother is a beautiful temperament, absolutely gorgeous, real nice dog.
Uh-huh.
I have other dogs as well.
All right.
But I thought, you know...
All right, then. So anyone who's interested, by all means, give us a ring here, and you know what the situation is. The wee dogs are there. And if they're not snapped up, they will be, well...
They will be.
Okay, so
Jerry,
that's...
it's in your hand.
Oh, I know. Well, don't blame me if nobody rings. But I'm sure people will.
Yes, well, I have to blame my husband for letting the dog out. He's at fault for having puppies anyhow.
Ah, but then if he didn't let the dog out, the dogs wouldn't be, the wee pups wouldn't be there at all.
No, I have to blame him. I have to blame someone, you two.
And who are you, God? You can't deny pups' life. Sorry, I'm getting excited now. All right, then. Okay.
And I'll deliver them anywhere.
You'll deliver them anywhere?
Anywhere.
Well, that's a bonus. Okay, thank you very much. We'll ask people to ring. The number's 0845... What is the number here?
08459.
Oh, yeah. 5556... 08459-555-678. Why sometimes can I not remember that? I think there's something wrong with me. Mm-hmm. I think I'm turning into Iris. Okay, then. Thanks very much.
That would be great if you could do that.
We'll do that.
Marvellous.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye. Look, here's a letter mentioning you and Geraldine.
Just before you read it, what's the collective term for a group of rooks? This is not a quiz question.
It's a church, isn't it?
A church of rooks?
I think so.
I don't think so.
Well...
Would it be a
colony? All right, then a chapel then.
I don't know. Would it be a colony?
A colony of rooks?
It doesn't sound right, does it? Doesn't sound right. Does it sound right to you?
It sounds neither right nor wrong. It just sounds silly. A colony of rooks?
A lady has got a colony of rooks in her garden, and she wants to know how would she get rid of them.
Oh, she said a colony of rooks.
Yeah, she said a colony, but...
So you're trying to pick holes in her...
I'm not... It doesn't sound right. That's odd. A colony of rooks, does it? Did you ever hear that before?
I think she's basically trying to tell you that she's got more than one.
She's got a rake of rooks.
A rake of rooks is better.
Mm-hmm.
A rake of rooks in the roof.
And how would she get
a rake of rooks in the roof space.
Aye.
Okay.
And David now wants to ask you about beer.
Does he? All right. I want to read this letter first. Dear Jerry,
Turn
this is from,
me off.
No, this it involves you. This is from a lady in Bangor. I've just spoken to Geraldine, who's a delightful girl... stating, I really didn't think you should be boasting about how your show bettered John Bennett's regarding lost animals. Now, Jerry, your show is superior. It makes my morning, and so do my animals. Do you know what I found out a few weeks ago? And this may be something that you might find hard to understand. And the reason why it brought to mind, I was writing a little thing last night for...
Belfast Telegraph?
Yes.
I'll say it, don't worry.
And I suddenly remembered that I am probably the only broadcaster who... is listened to by ostriches.
Right.
I met a man the other day. Now, this is absolutely true. And anyone who wants to know about this can read this article on Friday. I met a man the other day and he was drunk.
Is that the article in the Belfast Telegraph?
This Friday.
This Friday.
Yeah. And funnily enough, you should. It is the article in the Belfast Telegraph this Friday. Yeah. It's about this man, and I met this man, and he was a man from Dublin.
But if you tell us now, then we'll not buy it.
I'll just tell you one thing. This man told me that his ostriches listen to this program. They don't even listen to Hugo.
Right.
Right? And I said to him, how did you know? And he said, when ostriches listen to your program, they put one leg up underneath them. And he said, when the program's finished, the legs come down again. And he said, they keep their two legs on the floor for Hugo and George and everybody.
I
said, I'm the only one they lift their leg for.
Yes.
Oh, the birds love me. They do indeed.
Right.
Anyway... I tape your show every morning and send it to my sister in England, who in turn then sends the tapes to my brother. Not only do you make my mornings Monday to Friday, you make other parts of the day so enjoyable for us. However, this morning when you were talking with a delightful lady from Thailand about Coco, her cat, you did say how your show had the edge on the others because of the concern shown for animals, as was displayed by my treatment of the pups just there now. And indeed, it certainly gave me that impression until about 4 weeks ago when I phoned in desperation about my very elderly cat, Ivor, who went missing from home 4 days before. I spoke with Mr. Coyle, giving him a description of Ivor, very elderly, grey, with a white chest and feet.
Yeah.
Sounds like John Bennett.
Yeah.
But his most distinguishing feature was he had only one eye. I explained as briefly as I could, unlike this letter, that he was microchipped, and I had exhausted all the conventional methods, that is, shelters, vets, advertising, etc. Also, that I was very distressed.
Oh, turn me off.
No, this is important. Also, that I was very distressed as we were running out of scenarios, and I was hoping against hope he had charmed his way into someone's home and they didn't know to phone the local shelters and the person maybe listened to your show, etc. I told him I'd be very grateful if Mr. Anderson would read this out for me. Sean very diligently took all the details, murmured the right sympathetic noises, but when he asked me for my telephone number, I only got 02891 out and he said, right, thanks very much.
Yes.
I knew then my chances of getting my message across were slim. Optimistically, I waited, but I was right, not to mention a survivor. I was devastated. What have you got to say for yourself?
Absolutely correct.
You thought our number was 02891?
I probably wasn't listening.
You weren't listening?
Yeah.
Jerry, I'm delighted you helped Mrs. Turner find her beloved Coco. My heart went out to her when you read her email and knew exactly how she felt and hoped she would find Coco. Incidentally, Ivor came home the following Sunday. Very, very thin, with no indication of where he may have been. As indeed many of us do on a Sunday morning. We suspect perhaps he had accidentally been locked into someone's garage. I, like Ms. Turner, regard my animals very much as my family. I have a daughter, three cats and a dog. But Jerry, please believe me, I am delighted about Coco. But what's the difference between Coco and Ivor, eh? Your show is good. Jerry, you're wonderful. Geraldine is wonderful. Geordie is wonderful. Michael is wonderful. James is wonderful. Sean is not. Please make sure your claims are correct before spouting them. It may not be a totally besotted fan writing to you the next time. That you told off.
Yeah.
That'll be the last time you'll cut off a woman when she's given you her number.
David.
Hello? What's that now?
David must be on some one of the ones that you're not on.
Hello, David.
Hello.
Yeah, there he is. Yes, David.
Hi,
I'm all right, thanks.
I tell you what it is. I'm looking the recipe for ginger beer.
Ginger beer?
Aye.
A recipe for ginger beer. How exciting.
My grandmother used to make it.
Yes.
And there's nothing like the bottle stuff at all.
I would be prepared to concede that, yes. So, I don't know what to say to you except to say that maybe someone will send us one in.
That's what I was thinking.
All right. So when was the last time you had a good ginger beer? Oh, he's breaking up. Sorry, we've lost him. Yes, that's very exciting, Sean. Thank you for that call for the recipe for ginger beer.
And you look into a child's face. You were seeing only human race. The endless possibilities there, where so much can come true. And you think of the beautiful things a child can do. How long can a child survive? How long, if it was up to you? When you think about the money spent on defense by the government, the weapons of destruction we built, we're so sure that we need. And you think of the millions and millions that money could feed. How long can you hear someone crying? How long can you hear someone dying before you ask yourself why? How long will we hear people speaking about missiles for peace and just let it go by? How long will they tell us these weapons are keeping us free? It's a lie. If you saw it from a satellite, with its green and with its blue and white, the beauty of the curve of the earth and the oceans below, you might think it was paradise if you didn't know. You might think it was turning, but it's turning so slow. Can you hear someone crying? How long can you hear someone dying before you ask yourself why? How long will it be till we've turned to the tasks and the skills we'll have to have learned if we're going to find our place in the future, have something to offer where this planet's concerned? How long? How long?
Christy Moore, of course, that's a song called How Long, written by Jackson Browne. You don't see him about too much these days. Nor indeed do you see Christy Moore about much these days. I've got some requests here to play. Email address is jerry.anderson@bbc.co.uk. There's a recipe for ginger beer just came in. What an exciting call that was, Sean. I'm sorry we lost that.
Yeah.
I was really looking forward to a riveting conversation about recipes for ginger beer.
Yeah.
And I'm glad that you put that through to me.
If there's and a Jim and
unfortunate that the man, you know, lost his line.
But there's a Jim and Marina Conkey. What is it, Conkey or McConkey?
Conkey?
Marina Conkey.
Marina Conkey?
Yeah, they live in the Ballyclare area. Would they contact Betty Proctor?
All right. Okay. There's two recipes here, one for ginger beer, and lo and behold, and I hesitate to say this, also one for lemon-based ginger beer, which seems to me like an abomination before the Lord. Alias Gloria O'Donnell writes to me and she says, listen to your programme at the moment. Please play a special birthday request for my mum, Agnes Call from Oma, who will be 84 tomorrow, the 4th of April. Congratulations to you, Agnes. Call from Oma, nothing to Brian. Oh, she is not Brian Call's mother. She is his aunt. Sorry, a little addition there at the
Hello,
end. A little.
Is the boss man there?
Pardon?
Okay.
Sorry. Microphone left on. I found this, says Steve Barnes, on the British Hedgehog website. Now, there are people out there who didn't know that existed, but now you know. This is a diet for a hedgehog. You may want to get a pencil and paper. I'll just wait until you get that. You may not need your thinking cap, but get a pencil and paper. This is what a hedgehog should eat. A suitable diet includes minced meat, tinned cat or dog food, not fish-based, thereby proving Geordie right, chicken leftovers, including carcass, other forms of protein such as scrambled egg, chopped peanuts, and grated cheese. Fibre should also be given by way of breakfast cereal, crushed unsweetened digestive biscuits, or cat biscuits. Fresh water should always be available. Cow's milk should not, in big letters, be given. Don't give a hedgehog cow's milk. Might set it mad. And here's a man called Malcolm McRae who sends me an email from, of all places, the Golan Heights, on the border with Lebanon and Syria. He said, hello there from northern Israel. Yes, you're listened to over here loud and clear on the internet. Living here in the north, at the bottom of the Golan Heights and on the border with Lebanon and Syria, I'd like to say hello to all the folks over there. My family are the McRae's in Five Mile Town, and hello to the Lynns in Enniskillen and also Belfast. In spite of all the news, things are going on as normal here in Israel. You see, it's like here. You know, people in America, they hear about Northern Ireland and they think that we're all, you know, been blown up. As a matter of fact, only a small number of us are being blown up or shot. And in Israel, you think that everybody's getting blown up. As a matter of fact, you know, they are. But keep up the good work. There are at least two people out here in out-town Kiryat Shamona who listen to my good neighbour Dermot and myself. Any sort of a quiet song, that's if I get a choice. Well, if a man goes all the way to write to me from northern Israel, he should have a choice. I'm going to play a nice little song now. And this is here, just have a listen to this. This is from Paul Simon. Paul Simon once had an album out, which I think was the best thing he ever did, and nobody ever bought it, of course. It's called One Trick Pony. Some beautiful songs on it. I think this is him at his peak. And here's a song called, which is one of my favourites, which nobody else has ever heard of. It's called God Bless the Absentee.
traveling with this five-piece band. I play the ace of spades. I have a wife and family, but they don't see much of me. God bless the absentee. Lord, I am a surgeon, and music is my knife. It cuts away my sorrow, purifies my life. But if I could release my heart from veins and arteries, I'd say God bless the absentee. I miss my woman so, I miss my bed, I miss those soft places I used to lay my head. My son don't need me yet, his bones are soft, he flies a silver airplane, he wears a golden cross. God bless the absentee. Lord, this country's changed so fast. The future is the present, the present's in the past.
If there's one thing on earth that makes me depressed, it's sitting waiting on the wife getting dressed. I swear to watch her, she would drive you insane. Some of her antics I'll try and explain. Now we're asked out to this fancy do, and I'm sitting shining from me head to my shoe. I've shampooed and I've shaved, and I've had a wee shower. All done, you might say, in a third of an hour. But Maggie, she's different, I'll have you to know. I can't think of a word that's slower than slow. Now, she'll not have a shower in case she might slide, so the bath is filled up and Radox applied. She'll slop and she'll splash, she'll sing and she'll laugh. You would swear there's a crocodile let loose in her bath. She rubs and she scrubs, and the one hair she got set is tied back with a scarf in case it gets wet. Then she dries herself well with four towels or more, and the powder she uses is like snow on the floor. I believe she's a magician, because from this wee box with a flap, her Maggie can produce a full gamma shop. There's creams and there's lotions, all colours so bright, and wee dainty paint brushes, boys, they're a sight. There's lipstick and polish and bottles of spray, and wee things to pull out those hairs that's torn grey. And the faces she makes, boys, it's a tara, as she thickly applies that stuff called mascara. On the back of her lugs are then perfumed and scented. Bad luck to the day that stuff was invented. How did the old folks do in the days that's gone by, when there was no such thing as hairspray or dye? For the price of one of those bottles, I haven't a doubt, a man could buy a full case of stout. Now her makeup is on and she's powdered her nose, but the worst bit of all, it's when she's picking her clothes. There's no seeing on earth a bet will compare as a woman complaining, I've nothing to wear. Now in front of the wardrobe, she twists and she whinges, and the bloody thing sitting stuffed to the hinge. With dresses all sizes, colours so gay, some meant for the sunshine or cold winter's day. So with one hand on her hinge and one on her chin, She examines the contents that's hanging within. Then the clanging of hangers rings a lurd in me head as a dozen or so outfits are flung on the bed. Now, I sit and say nothing, for I know that it's best. I'm sitting ready. She's the one that's not dressed. Now, in front of the mirror, she'll stand and she'll grin. The first one tried on. She pulls herself in. She'll pivot, she'll smile, she'll pose and she'll sway. That doesn't look right. She throws it away. The next one's the same, she tries then, she throws. Still complaining, I've no bloody clue. Now, I try to ignore her, though she's hard for to miss. Then me attention she demands. Do I look all right in this? Oh, Maggie, it's perfect, is my instant reply. And may God forgive me if I tell her a lie. For this waiting and watching would drive you to tears. I've been watching her antics this 20-odd years. And the more that I watch, I think she's not wise. When she's picking her clothes, does she not think of her size? Or maybe it's me, I'm just easy depressed. Or is this the done thing when any woman gets dressed? She's me all confused. I'm in a terrible state. The dew was at 9. It's now 10. And we're late. Thanks very much.
That's Patsy O'Hagan. That's from an album called Just a Bit of Crack. That's a song called, not a song at all, that's a poem called Getting Dressed. And before that, we had God Bless the Absentee from Paul Simon from an album called One Trick Pony. Hello?
Hi.
I'm trying to remember all this off the top of my head. Who's that?
This is Rosalie.
Rosalie?
Yeah, I spoke to you about a year ago when I was here before.
That's right. Where were you from again? Remind me.
Maryland.
That's right.
Yeah.
And you were going back then?
Yes, and I came back to stay for a while again.
And why is that? The pull of the Emerald Isle, is it?
Oh, yeah. There's a man over here I'm going to marry.
Oh.
Yeah, send out my love to David, too.
David as well?
No, David.
You see, you must not put the intrusive two in there.
That's true.
Because we would get the wrong impression.
Yeah.
So, yeah, had you met him the last time? I can't really remember the details.
Yeah, I do photography.
Yeah.
And work on movie sets, doing still shots.
That's right.
And I was having you try to find Frank Scantori, because I couldn't find his email address, and I went crazy there for a little while, but I got it.
You found him eventually?
Yeah.
You take photographs of the stars and that kind of thing,
yes,
do you?
Yes, I do.
Well, what kind of people have you taken photographs? Because everybody's yearning for me to ask.
I've worked with Tom Cruise, Paul Newman.
You've taken their photographs?
Clint Eastwood. Yeah, I have them. I have all. In fact, I have them on my laptop right here.
Have you?
Yeah.
You go up to the leg of Tom Cruise and say, Tom, would you put your left leg over there just a little?
Oh, I can't stand Tom Cruise.
Really?
He's an arrogant son of a gun.
Oh, that's the kind of stuff we want here.
Uh-huh.
That's why I keep asking people. Nobody ever answers me, but you sound like my kind of woman. You're prepared to talk about these people.
Vicious
Who's
woman.
The most... I just ask you the question that I ask many people who know celebrities. Who's the most hateful you've ever met?
Burt Reynolds.
Really?
I despise the guy, yes.
Really? What's wrong with him?
When I was at his house with my father, he treats women like hell.
Does he really?
Yeah. He's very crude son of a gun. That's all I can say.
Is that right? He says bad things, does he?
Beyond.
Oh.
He's very, very abusive.
All right, that's good, right? Yeah. I'm not saying that's good, but it's good to know that.
You should have known that from Sally Fields.
Yeah, right.
When he was with her.
Uh-huh. And I saw him in that film. What was that film? Oh, dear. Boogie Nights.
Mm-hmm.
Is he like that?
Not really.
It's not like,
no.
I thought maybe he might have been playing himself there.
A little bit, probably. A little bit.
And you don't like Tom Cruise either?
No. No. He might have matured a little bit.
When did you last see him?
Well, I worked with him when he was doing Days of Thunder.
Oh, God, yeah.
And that was when he was a real young brat, working with Paul Newman on... the Lime Rock.
Paul Newman seems to be a nice man. I don't know if he is or not.
He is a sweetheart.
Who's the nicest one you've ever met?
Paul Newman.
Really?
Paul Newman is a sweetheart. Yes. Yeah. What I was calling you about was that mm-hmm. ad in the paper.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that was really good. I agree with you on the tips. Half the time, I never tip half the Americans.
I don't know. I've got a thing about that. I don't know what it is, you know, because I just can't... I've always been the same. It's not meanness. It's just that I think when people hold out their hand for a tip, I just don't give them one.
Well, what it is over in America, the pay is lower, first of all, for the, you know, the waitresses and things like that.
Mm.
But
when it comes to service, there's a lot of waitresses I have not left a tip for. And I've gotten up and told the manager, you know, it's beyond, you know, why they should be working that type of work.
Yeah, but, you know, it's partly to do with what they do over here, I think, in some cases, that they charge you 10% service charge, then they keep it.
Mm-hmm.
And then they just don't pay the waiters and the waitresses. And so no matter what you do, if you leave a tip, you know, they keep it anyway. And, you know, it's just kind of weird. And I think, you know, if somebody's working for you, you know, pay them.
Right.
And don't be expecting people like me and you to be giving them a fiver here and a fiver there, whatever it is, you know, yeah, because you feel sorry for them. That's like throwing crumbs to a cat.
That's right.
You know? Mm. So anyway, what about this boyfriend of yours? Is he responding?
Fiance?
Yes.
Yeah.
He's responding.
He's home right now from work.
Good. Well, what are you going to do? You think you might live here, or are you going to trail him off to America?
No, I want to live here. He wants to live there.
Wait, yep. What is it? Who's that? Anderson? All right. So where would you like to live? I don't want to talk to him. I don't like the sound of him.
Ah, he just said he doesn't like the sound of you, David.
He sounds aggressive. He sounds a bit Burt Reynolds to me.
He sounds like Burt Reynolds. That's great.
So where would you like to live here? If you had your choice, one particular place.
Northern Ireland.
But whereabouts? Would you like to live in Antrim? Would you like to live on the shores?
I'd actually like to live by the seashore.
Do you know where I'd like to live?
Where?
Glenarm.
Glenarm?
Yeah.
Have I been there, David?
Not yet.
You should go.
Where I like is, you know where that rope bridge is at?
Carrickarreed.
Okay.
Carrickarreed.
I fell in love with that. Oh, he just said, always tip a taxi driver.
Obviously, your husband is your fiancé is a taxi driver.
Yes.
How did I gather that?
Mm.
I'll tell you, I've got a lovely song, which, do you know what I might do? I might send it to you.
Oh, I'd love that.
It's from an Irish-American singer from New York,
mm-hmm.
And her name is Kathy Ryan. And did you ever hear of a band called Cherish the Ladies?
No, I haven't.
They're quite big in the Irish-American community, but you may not be tuned into them over there. And she has written a song called Carrickarreed,
mm-hmm.
And it's absolutely beautiful.
Well, let me ask you one thing. I sent you in a CD of a band that I was promoting from over here,
yes,
called Kava.
Oh, yes.
And I was wondering if you could play a song of theirs by chance on your web designer had said, do a flop idol competition. Come on. I've got a list here of things I want to get on you about.
my web designer?
Yeah. Yeah.
You mean my web saboteur? Yeah. Yeah, there's a thing on there, which there's a couple of things on there of which I know nothing, but I know about this flop idol. This wasn't my idea. This was Mr. Coyle's idea. Mm-hmm. And may I say,
I think it was a very, very good idea.
No, it's a flawed idea.
It's a very good idea.
It's a flawed idea.
No, it's a very,
it's
very good idea.
Thank you.
And I, you know what?
No, because,
I'm going to have to come down there and protest in front
hold
of your building
a hold on
if
a second.
Don't do this.
Mr. Coyle, tell them that there's somebody talking in my ear and I don't know who it is.
There's somebody talking in his ear and he doesn't know who it is.
I'm sorry, it's not you there. There's a man from another studio talking in my ear, shouting at me. Sorry about that. It happens here every once in a while, coming around, and whoever goes in and gets the news ready, they're all shouting at each other and they press the wrong button and they're all shouting at me. It's not me. It's not my pig. Anyway, what was the name of that band again?
Kava.
C-A-V-A.
Correct.
Right, I remember them. I don't know. No, I didn't play them. I think I put them on the long finger.
You did. And I'm so upset that you did, because they really are a good band.
All right, then. I'll tell you what. I'll resurrect them. I'll bring them out from the bottom of the pile.
You're a sweetheart.
I will indeed.
Okay, and I'll give you my address after, and you can mail off that.
I will, actually. Yes, I'll send that to you, because I think you'll like that, because it's really special.
Okay, great.
Okay. Well, enjoy the rest of your trip, and maybe you're staying here.
I'm going to be staying here till probably for the next few months.
Okay. Okay, Rosalind, and tell me, give me a name, some other names of people you photograph, just to make people jealous.
Oh, my word.
Go on. What's Clint Eastwood like?
I'm sorry? Clint Eastwood?
Yeah.
He's a sweetheart.
Is he nice?
Yes, very, very nice. I'll bring by my laptop and show you a list.
All right, then. Okay. Bring by your laptop.
Okay.
Okay, see you later.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye. Bye. She's going to bring by her laptop.
Could you do Stanley a wee quick favour, but don't mention his name, he's on too.
No, he's not.
Is he away?
Yeah.
Is he on one?
Hello, Stanley.
No, he went away then.
He went away.
That's
very bad. Let me hear that noise again. Wow.
He was actually looking two wings for a Ford Anglia.
Looking two wings for a Ford Anglia.
Yeah.
Hello to Doreen Stewart, 35th wedding anniversary today. That's from her husband, Jim. And hello to our sister, Kathy. Happy birthday. That's from Eileen and Mary. Looking two. Here's a recipe. The man who's looking for the recipe for the ginger beer, if he'll ring back, have you got his address?
How does she get taken the photographs of those stars?
Well, she works on. She takes stills. She works for film companies. She takes stills.
What's she doing here?
She's found a taxi driver.
And she gave up taking photographs in Hollywood, Beverly Hills?
We'll talk to her again. She fares a taxi driver. And I think she's right. Back a bit of reality. Is that all, you're right here, love? You know, that's stuff. That's all we have time for. We'll be back tomorrow at approximately 10:30. It's 12 o'clock.